It's our weekly update with the director of track and field and cross country, Rod DeHaven. And weather is not kind to us at the moment. We're just going to start with this in general because you are wearing the effects of the rain that we have in Brookings here today. So Mother Nature just less than ideal here in this month of April.
Actually, I haven't dried out since Saturday night in Azusa. So is it raining? I can't tell. It just seems like, we didn't have rain yesterday. So yes, I jest.
Do you get wetter if you sprint through the rain or if you just walk at a normal pace?
It's the same.
It's the same?
Yeah.
Have you done the research on this?
I have not done the research.
Okay,
I'm going to throw that out there as fact.
Okay. All right. So we're locked in on this. You mentioned you were in Azusa. You had some folks all over. And we want to highlight the highlighted individuals. But we need to begin with Ethan Fisher because when you have a school record and what a throw he had, that's very impressive stuff.
Yeah, I think for Ethan, it's something that you could see coming during the indoor season. We hosted some of those indoor competitions. And then I imagine once you get outside, you press a bit because you've got, the regional qualifier, and that's a kind of a moving line in the sand. And then you also have the school record. So you've got these two kind of things that probably weigh on you because it's very attainable and you get so many cracks at it, so you press and finally first throw at the Pacific Coast Invitational, it gets that done, and that's a really good thing because now the focus can be a little bit, I'm sure he's going to be a little bit more relaxed in the ring, whether it's Drake Relays, Summit League Championships or any other meet that we happen to contest up until the regional meet. And I think in my very untrained eye that, potentially there's another 10 to 15 feet that he can obtain. And, that gives him a, reasonable shot, to make the NCAA finals. And that's obviously a very big deal. And that's what, you want kids that, trying to obtain those types of goals. And Ethan's definitely one of them.
And I was just going to say, and this is not exclusive to Ethan, we've talked about this with a number of athletes, but one of the things I know you really enjoy is watching some of these student athletes who you see what they might be capable of. You try to convince them of that. Then they go out and they steadily improve and they hit those strides or even exceed some of your goals. That's very special to you.
It is, but, with Ethan, obviously the first time I saw him, it's like he's 6'8". And he's got long arms. And he's thinking, okay, this guy can throw a discus. And he doesn't have meat hooks for hands, so he's good. Right? He can throw that platter around. So that wasn't super hard to forecast.
Thank you for completely stomping all over the thesis of my...
I'm not sure I listened to most of your questions.
Thank you for finally admitting it on camera. Outside of Ethan, though...
10 years ago, I couldn't remember your name, so where are we at?
you've called me a lot of things over the years. Some of them we can even say on camera. But nevertheless, outside of Ethan, who else stood out to you this weekend?
Well, down at Pacific Coast in the Long Beach meet, I think Millie Young also threw very well in the discus. Had an opening meet that wasn't so great. Had missed, I think, for ROTC the second meet, and then threw very well out there. Threw 158 feet, which I thought was really solid. And again, that environment for kids that haven't been in it, because you see a lot of schools with Power Five schools, big names, and schools from all over the country, and how kids are going to react is not totally predictable in that fashion. And she threw well in both those meets, and good to see her do that. Madison Kaiser also jumping 5.7.5, I think, at both meets. Having that consistency that we talked about is very important. Being able to rely on somebody at a conference meet is going to be a big deal. I think there were, in the vault, Lacey Leverty, close to getting to 13 feet, just that one more bar, and that's likely going to happen for her. And, again, the exposure for some of the younger people that went there was important. Weather largely until late Saturday afternoon was okay. I think that derailed a Matt Katz from maybe having a little bit better meet because it finally did start to open up as far as the skies down at Long Beach. Over at Azusa, we kicked off with Ryan Benson at decathlon, and Ryan had a really good multi. I would say that his consistency across all the events was really good. I think if he said, which event wasn't great, his jab could have been better. There's always that one more bar in the high jump that he could have made, one more bar in the pole vault could have made, but did really well, and I think we're starting to accelerate a little bit after, you know, the injury during the indoor season, and just kind of using the indoor conference championships as kind of the kickoff of what felt like the year. And so I think there's a lot more in him, and I think he can take a swing probably at our school record by the time we're done here in St. Paul at the Summit League Champs. I think for the sprints group that went out there, you know, one of the things with Southern California is you hope for hot weather days and cooler nights. On Saturday, we got cool headwinds, and you know, that's a little frustrating when you deal with that. I thought Savannah Rizow ran really well in the hurdles, despite, you know, the headwind. She breaks 14 seconds there. Our 4x1s, both on the men's and women's side, did well in that environment. I think our men probably lament maybe one hand off, but I think for the ladies, you know, pretty quality stuff there. And you know, again, being exposed to that environment was, you know, good for them. You know, being exposed to, you know, that type of travel, you know, is important for their development. And I think Jake Werner also ran really well in the 200, you know, despite a little bit of a headwind as well. And even though it might have sent a positive wind, it was, you ran straight into basically that wind in your first around the bend there. So that was good. I think the distance stuff there, and oftentimes this is what this meet is known for, we got a lot of what we wanted out of it. Leah Hiskin runs personal best just short of Rachel King's, you know, school record. And, you know, for Leah, it's been, you know, a lot of her PRs were from 2021. And there's a lot of things that have happened for her to, you know, it would have been easy just to kind of go through the motions and be done and, you know, move on to the next phase of her life. But she's fought really hard this spring, and cool to see that. Whether or not that 5K or 10K at Stanford gets her into regionals, it's more of a waiting game at this point. You know, Jess Lettmer, two PRs in the 1500 and 5K, you know, really solid stuff there too. Not top 10 mark for sure in that 5K. Claire Beckman, a couple of personal bests outdoors-wise. Probably not exactly what she wanted, but still going out there and taking advantage of the situation was good. On the men's side, Cody Larson and Brandon Kamstead both had really outstanding meets. Cody Larson probably put himself in a pretty solid position to make the regional meet with his 8:52 steeplechase, and then comes back the next night and runs 14:03. In the 5K, Brandon Kamstead runs 150 and 3:46, and you know, those are pretty solid marks for a first year guy. And, certainly, I don't think we've had anybody run faster than that this year. And I think the one thing that definitely stood out, those races were very physical. No longer in Sauk Center, as I think I'd like to tell. That there was a lot of pushing, shoving, trying to, you know, employ swim moves to get between two guys type of stuff. So maybe with cleaner races and nothing that, you know, he could necessarily dictate, that, you know, certainly he can go a bit faster there. And Carson Knocker continues to be Carson Knocker, runs 14:08, which would also be the best ever for a first year, you know, student athlete at SDSU. So, you know, largely it the weekend did what it needed to do for us, and certainly we're hungry and want to keep climbing, and hopefully get some stuff done here.
Well, and so with that, we're inside of a month from St. Paul, as you mentioned, and the Summit League Championships. We don't know what exactly this weekend's going to look like because of Mother Nature. So rather than trying to figure out where you may or may not end up, you said you still need to work on some things. What needs to happen here in the next 3 weeks to get you ready for the Summit League Championships?
Yeah, I think for that group that went to California, certainly recovering is, you know, a big piece of that. That it'd be easy to say, all right, let's dive into it and really – really work hard, and that will happen later in the week for a good majority of that group. I think, you know, getting everybody fully healthy, getting them fully engaged, and getting them, you know, their minds ready for not only the athletic pursuits but the academic, you know, tasks that they have to tackle here at the end of the year, and coupled with a lot of, you know, travel and unpredictable travel that's going to come up during that during this 3 week stretch leading into the, you know, the last to the conference championships. And we have to be at our very best for us to have one, any sort of chance on the men's side of the conference meet, and two, on the women's side, to be able to climb up a spot at the conference meet. Definitely going to need to be firing on all cylinders and not have our best events be, you know, the Brian Clay invite or, you know, the USD early bird or, you know, USD Challenge last weekend, where we did have some good stuff there. But we've got to scratch and claw to, you know, find some more points on both sides. And you know, that's the task that myself and the rest of the coaching staff will be challenged with.